y'all last week, and good to be back. Philippians chapter 2, verses 12 and 13. Philippians chapter 2, verses 12 and 13. We're going to talk about don't quit. Now, we do know that we don't work to be saved, but because we are saved.
Amen.
The difference between Christianity and all other religions is this. They must do something in order to be saved. In Christianity, Christ has already done it.
Amen.
He did the work of our salvation. So when we look at this passage, we'll see when it says, work out your own salvation. Was Paul contradicting himself? Are we truly saved by works? Must we do works to stay saved? The passage has, this passage has the answer to all those questions. But but not just about salvation only. This passage encourages us to continue to build. I forgot to start. We've got to start all over again. No. This passage encourages us to build on our walk with Christ, to continue to grow in the knowledge of Him as we walk with Him each day. We should grow. We don't get saved again and again and again and again. One Lord, one faith, one baptism. We are saved once and are free to follow the Lord each day and in every way acknowledging Him. Once we accept Christ as our Savior, we're free to follow Him. He invites us to follow Him. He invites us to come to Him and walk with Him each day. What a privilege we have. We have a no-so salvation, not a hope-so salvation. No-so. Paul said, I know in whom I believe. He that hath Christ hath life. If you don't have Christ, you don't have life. That's basically the decision every man, woman, boy, and girl has to make on this planet Earth. I know we have a new administration, but we still have the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
He's still on the throne. And He's coming to get His church. That hasn't changed. We're saved and free to acknowledge Him. We don't have to worry about punching the time clock of works. The time clock of work salvation. We don't have to punch that time clock every day. Once you're saved, you get it all up front. It's like going to work in a factory that pays you all 30 years in advance and retirement also. Now think about that. You're vested immediately in the kingdom of God for all eternity when you trust in Jesus Christ. You cannot lose a job that's already paid for, that you've already been paid to do, and you're already vested in. Now you can quit coming to work each day, but you're still vested in the company, and that won't change because they've already paid you forever. But sadly, a lot of Christians are staying at home today. Because they've quit on the Lord. They've gotten more concerned about social issues than scriptures. They've gotten more concerned about life issues than the Lord. Knowing the Lord can take care of everything in our lives and fulfill all our needs. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and nothing else will be added unto you. You're on your own. All these things shall be added unto you. That should be your life verse, or one of them. Matthew 6:33. Listen. People have become bogged down in worldly activities and concerns. They've gotten lazy and just keep hitting the snooze button instead of going to work. I'm thankful to say I never hit a snooze button in 37 years of work. You think Cindy would let me get by with that? It might be cause some problems. So I usually got right up on on the first buzzer. Actually, the secret I always told people was to set your alarm clock across the bedroom. So you got to get up to turn it off. That's what I did for 37 years. Now where's my alarm? I ain't got one. Sorry. That's right. Man, we don't have an alarm. We are our own alarm, aren't we? The world answers to us, right?
Get up in your diapers.
Yes, pretty much. When I absolutely have to get out of bed to use the bathroom, that's when I get up. Unfortunately, that's about 5 o'clock. One day the factory's going to move. You know, we've gotten lazy, hit the snooze button, don't want to go to work for the Lord. But one day the factory's going to move, and you're going to be very ashamed because you have not checked out the new location. You didn't know what was going on because you've been going, you've not been coming to work every day and keeping up with things. And once the church is raptured, you wind up in a new location, you're going to be ashamed and embarrassed because you weren't looking for it.
That's right.
So I urge you, I know I'm speaking to the choir today because you're here, but don't quit. If you're thinking about quitting and giving up, don't quit. Let's look at verse 12 of Philippians chapter 2. Wherefore, my beloved, as ye have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but how much more in my absence. Don't quit just because I'm gone. The Apostle Paul is writing here. Don't quit just because I'm gone. He says, dear friends, as you've always obeyed me when I was with you, it's even more important that you obey me now while I'm away from you. Therefore, my dear ones, as you've always obeyed my suggestions, though now not only with enthusiasm you should show in my that you would show in my presence, much more enthusiasm because I'm absent. That's what Paul is saying. He didn't want them to quit while he was gone or get lazy or lackadaisical because Paul was not with them to teach them in person. He had to move on. He left the church behind. And he expected them and encouraged them to continue on in the faith. Now, Paul was not with them. Paul's not with us today. We have his writings. Jesus is not with us bodily. But we carry on anyway because Jesus is in us. His Spirit is in us. Paul's teaching was in them. Paul's teaching is in us. We're reading his teaching today. It was doubly important for the Philippian church to continue on in Paul's absence. It's doubly important that we continue on in this day when the Lord is absent from us. Because we're going to meet Him one day and give an account of how we served Him. Not about sin. We were talking about that in Sunday school this morning, about the crowns. It's not about our sin. That's been paid for on the cross. It's about your work for Christ. But Jackson said you're not saved by works. No, you're not saved by working, but you are rewarded for your works for Christ. Actually, your faithfulness to Christ is how we're rewarded. So, doubly important, triply important. I can't emphasize the importance of serving the Lord while He's absent. The Bible implores us to follow the Lord in His absence. The Bible says you'll be blessed greatly because you don't see. Blessed are they that have not seen and yet have believed. We haven't seen the Lord, but we trust in His Word and in the testimony of those who've gone on before that Jesus Christ is Lord. We've experienced Him in our own lives. We've experienced the peace, the joy, the understanding. Now, how is it that you think about yourself before you were a Christian, what you knew nothing about the Bible, barely enough to get saved, and now when the Bible's opened up to you, the Lord's already working in your mind, isn't He, and showing you things. That's the Holy Spirit. You cannot understand the Bible apart from the Holy Spirit. That's why these people who naysay on the Bible, if they don't trust in Christ and get the illumination of the Holy Spirit, the Bible's too deep for them.
Amen.
You can't understand it with a carnal mind. Yes, you can understand enough to get saved. It's not difficult to understand the parts that the Lord tells us, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. That's pretty simple. And some of His stories and all that is pretty simple, but it's deep. If you want to get into the deep things of the Lord, the Holy Spirit will illuminate us. The Holy Spirit will give us assurance. The Holy Spirit will keep us fighting. Keep us in the game. We want to please Him. We want to demonstrate our faithfulness to Him. We've got to double our efforts in the absence of the boss. Listen, when the boss is away at work, I can tell you, if you're a person of integrity or not, when the boss is away, do you play? Or when the boss is away, do you stay at it? Are you going to be a person of integrity? You want to please Him? The Lord is gone. He's in heaven. Here we are. That's why a lot of people feel like they can sleep in today. They don't have to go to church today. The Lord's not going to be here. Jesus won't be here. So, what do they care? They'll make it up. Their idea is, well, I'll start going to church in the spring when it's warmer. Then when the spring comes, I'll start going to church in the summer when it's warmer. Then the summer comes, I'll start going to church in the fall when it's cooler. I'll start going to church in the winter. Not ever. They don't want to please Jesus. It doesn't matter to them. How do we get so hard-hearted? I've known people that are on fire for the Lord. Would do anything for Him. Witness to people. Visit hospitals, nursing homes. Some people will go to the mall. Well, Jack, it's the only time I have to sleep in. Is that a rule of life that you got to have a day to sleep in? We want to please the boss when he's absent. We want to demonstrate our faithfulness to him. When the boss is out, we want to demonstrate our faithfulness to him. And when the Lord is gone, we're going to be rewarded for our faithfulness to him because he is absent. But let me tell you, the real reason that we want to serve the Lord in his absence is we care about getting the work done. We care about people who need to know Christ. That's the main thing that's going to keep you coming to church and keep you serving the Lord, is you care about his work. It's important in your life. It's important that Jesus Christ's message go out through the world. It's important that you show support for this church and the message it preaches of Jesus Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. There is no greater work or effort you can put anything into than to serve the Lord Jesus Christ. There's nothing more honorable in the world, nothing more needful in the world, nothing you'll ever do more important than work in getting the gospel of Jesus Christ out to this world. Don't quit just because he's gone. Secondly, don't quit on your faith. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Keep on working with fear and trembling to complete your salvation. Work out, cultivate, carry out to the goal. Fully complete your own salvation with reverence and awe and trembling, self-distrust, with serious caution, tenderness of conscience, watchfulness against temptation, timidly shrinking from whatever might offend God and discredit the name of Christ. That's from the Amplified Bible. The writer of Hebrews encouraged believers to finish the race. Now, working out your own salvation with fear and trembling basically means finish the race. That's already been brought out in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1. Wherefore, seeing we are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. Let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Let us finish the race. This passage is not talking about working for your salvation, but working because of your salvation. Our salvation is too important to get discouraged and quit. Our salvation, because others depend upon us to finish the race. Others depend upon us to finish strong. See, if you don't finish strong in the Christian life, you won't be able to tell others about him. If you don't finish strong in the Christian race, your testimony will be no good and it's going to hurt people. People that watched you when you were on fire for Christ and see you now that you're floundering for Christ, it's going to affect them. It's going to hurt them. Listen, our salvation is too important for the person who needs to be saved to quit. Paul was telling them he couldn't save them, but every person has to be saved individually. Work out your own salvation. Every Christian has a responsibility to grow in their faith. It's your responsibility to grow in faith. God doesn't want you to be stagnant. That's what this verse is saying. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. He doesn't want you to be stagnant. He wants you to grow. He wants you to go. He wants us to grow in our faith like a planted garden, cultivated. You know, you grow a garden, you just can't throw seed in the ground and forget about it. You've got to cut the weeds out. You've got to cultivate it. You've got to fertilize it or whatever you do. You got to work a garden so it'll grow. Grow in their faith. The Lord wants us to grow. He wants us to mature in our faith. He wants us not only to grow strong, but to mature, to be mature Christians. That is, we can handle anything that the devil throws at us. And let me tell you, he's going to throw everything and the kitchen sink at you. If he thinks you've made up your mind to serve Christ, he is going to put some obstacles in your way. And the Lord will test you and try you and see if you mean it too. But the devil wants to destroy you. He does not want you. He doesn't care if you're saved. Once you're saved, there's nothing to do about it. But he sure doesn't want you to grow and mature in your faith. He definitely doesn't want you to mature. Because if you mature in your faith, it's not likely that you'll slack off in your faith. If you're mature in your faith. That's why the Bible says we need to get away from the milk of infants. As the Apostle Paul was looking at growing as a Christian. You need to get on meat. Babies can't drink milk. I mean, babies drink milk. Men don't drink milk. Real men don't drink milk. We drink iced tea. Or coffee. I see all these things on Facebook about what people do if they don't have their coffee. I hope we never find out. I know Kelly likes his coffee. I hope we never find out what happens to him on a day that he can't drink coffee. What are you going to do in heaven, Kelly?
Set up coffee makers.
All right. Just wanted to clear that up. And also, what?
Bun.
A bun coffee maker. What about everybody else's brands?
That's not a brand, that's a maker.
Okay, that's not a brand. Oh, it's not?
No, it's a coffee.
Oh, is it?
He's the authority on it.
What?
He's the authority on it.
He's the authority. Whatever he says, he's probably wrong, but we'll let him, we'll humor him. Okay. Because he's on coffee right now. And also, every Christian has a responsibility to grow in their faith. Also, to make their faith effective in their lives. That's what it says, work out your own salvation. Make your faith effective in your own life. And to be effective means that you affect others. You touch others. And your faith strengthens others. Does your faith strengthen other people's faith? Or are you a hindrance to other people's faith? That's what you're looking for, to affect people. To help people to grow. When they look at you, they say, that's what the kind of Christian I want to be. Well, that's the things I need to be doing. If they can do it, I can do it. Are you effective for Christ? Are you working out your own salvation with fear and trembling? Are you effective for Christ? And are you strengthening your faith to be able to carry you through any circumstance or trial? Are you strengthening your faith so you can, it'll carry you through any circumstance and trial? If your faith won't carry you through any, I don't care what it is, if it won't carry you through it, you are going back to square one. And the Lord has to start all over on you in your faith. Listen, He never promised you a rose garden. Trials and troubles. Jesus said, if they persecuted me, they will persecute you. If they killed me, they're going to try to kill you. We are very fortunate. I posted a Facebook article today about 900,000 Christians have been martyred for their faith in the last 10 years. That's 90,000 a year, 246 a day. And they don't pray for us to pray that we don't get persecuted. They pray that God will strengthen us through persecution. They don't mind being persecuted. They just don't want to grow weak in their faith. They want to grow. You know, the church flourishes when there's persecution. We in America have been spared. Like I said in the article, we have soft persecution. They just think we're idiots and we're irrelevant to society anymore, and the Bible means nothing. We're just irrelevant, and they may not hire you because certain things you believe at a job, but that's about all we go through. I think it's going to get worse. There's such a divide in this country, let me tell you. There is such a division that it's going to really affect this nation in the next 4 years if the Lord tarries. There is a divide. I mean, one side sees a zebra and they swear it's black. The other side sees a zebra and swears it's all white. That's how this country is divided. We cannot even come to an agreement. Yeah, it's black and white. Nope. It's either one or the other. And it's not going to get any better. Just like persecution of Christians, murder of Christians. Is that going to get better? I don't think so. And the fact is, 90% of the Christians killed were killed in Islamic nations. Yet, in China, which we're going to send an NBA team over there to play, and they kill thousands of Christians a year, and we're going to put NBA players over there. Yet we won't let an NBA team all-star game be held in North Carolina because they won't let men in the girls' bathrooms. But we'll send them over to China to play where they kill 10,000 Christians a year for no reason but they want to start a church or got caught going to church. Got caught with the Bible in Saudi Arabia. You'll have your head lopped off. Don't quit on your faith. And finally, God won't quit on you. Verse 13. For it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do His good pleasure. It is God which worketh in you. How can you quit on your faith when God is working? God's always at work in you to make you willing and able to obey His purposes. God, all you got to say is, Lord, I surrender to you. That's the most dangerous prayer you'll ever pray in your life, is, Lord, I surrender to your will, whatever you want me to do. If you ever say that prayer, you're in big trouble, Buster. Because God is going to use you. And He's going to work in your life. You can't be like the little boy said, Lord, use me. And the next day, his girlfriend left him. His car broke down. He flunked math. This is a high school student. His dog died. That was very dramatic. And his coffee maker tore up. He said, Lord, don't use me so much next time. Let's back off a little bit. Listen, the devil will try to destroy you, but I'd rather be on God's army and attack, strengthened by the Holy Spirit, and try to make it on my own.
Amen.
And be a weakling for Christ. You want to be a weakling for Christ? Us men talk about being strong. We want to be strong. We want to impress our girlfriends and our wives. We want to be impressive. But we don't want to impress them about spiritual things. We don't care if they're impressed about our spiritual lives. I always wanted Cindy to be impressed that I was a spiritual giant, not a pygmy. I wanted Cindy to know I was a man of God. I didn't always act that way. Of course not. I'm human. But that was more important to me, that Cindy saw me pray, knew I got up to pray, knew that I lived a Christian life, knew as I taught the Bible and knew the Bible. That was more important to me than anything. Listen. Men don't want to be spiritual giants. They want to be physical specimens and all this stuff. And strong, me, Tarzan, you, Jane. They don't want to be spiritual giants. They don't want to lead their families in prayer. That's sissified. Let me tell you something. Family that prays together stays together. And a husband and wife who pray together will never have an argument. Jack, that's not true. Yes, it is. If you know you've got to pray with her at night and humble yourself and pray with her, how are you going to tell her off 2 hours before bedtime? It's pretty tough. Because I hate repenting, don't you? I hate saying I'm sorry. When I get ready to yell at Cindy, I say, I've got to apologize later. I hate doing that. So I just let it go. God will not quit on His people. He'll never quit on us. He's made many, many promises to you and me to keep. And He intends to keep them all. to strengthen us, to carry us, to hold us, to gather us, to live in us, and to be with us, that we should not fear these days, but live in joyous victory and excitement of that day the Lord will do something wonderful in our lives. Tomorrow, do you look forward to tomorrow? Is this the way you face tomorrow, which is Monday? Oh, it's Monday. Another whole week. You should face the day and say, Lord, what are you going to do today? Because He's going to do something in your life every day. Lord, what is it you're going to do for me today? It's exciting. It's the way we should live. Live in anticipation of what the Lord's going to do for us today and tomorrow. Don't quit because Paul is gone. Don't quit because the Lord is gone. Don't quit on your faith. God won't quit on you. Don't quit is my word to the church today. Many already have, but don't you be one of them. Let's pray.